Wellington de Mello, one of the key researchers, and he's going to speak on rigidity and low dimensional dynamics. Please.
Okay, thank you. So I'm going to talk here about the simplest of all dynamical systems. And the phase space is just a circle. And we are going to consider so we have the circle, okay? And we have a smooth homeomorphism of the circle. The basic example is the family of rigid rotations. It's just x goes to x plus rho mod 1. So this is the family of the rigid rotation. Rho varies from 0 to 1. And it's clear that in this simple model here, the dynamical behavior depends on the this rho, and if rho is rational, then all orbits are dense, periodic, and they have the same period. And if it is irrational, all orbits are dense. This is very simple exercise. So we want to compare this situation with smooth homeomorphism of the circle. So we take a point in the circle, and we consider the iterates of this point by this homeomorphism. And I'm then xk is just the k iterate of x0, and then we look at the orbit. And then we take a point here in the circle also, and we look at the orbit of this point by the rotation. Okay, and then we want to see if they have the same ordering in the circle. For example, if we have the J iterator here and the L and K, we notice here that the L iterate is between the J iterate and the K iterate. And so we want to know if the same happens for the rigid rotation. And what Poincaré discovered was that if you take any smooth any homeomorphism of the circle without periodic point, then we can find a unique rotation such that the ordering of the orbit is the same. So we can consider the mapping that maps the k iterate in the k iterate of the rotation. And since this map is monotone, it extends to the closure of this orbit. And we get a semi-conjugacy to a rigid rotation. This mapping can be extended to the whole circle, being constant in the intervals in the complement of the closure of this orbit. So the dynamics under the combinatorial point of view is given by this model here, by the rotation. Then 30 years later, Danjoie came back to this problem, and he was able to prove that this conjugacy is not always the semi-conjugacy given by Poincaré was not always a conjugacy, because it's possible that the orbit of this C1 map is not dense, and he gave examples of that. And immediately he proved also that this cannot happen if the map is C2. If the homeomorphism is C2, then the orbits are dense, and therefore this H is a conjugacy between. And this number rho is given just by this limit where this map here is just the lift of the homeomorphisms to the real line. What I want to discuss here is going further from that, and I want to analyze the geometry of the orbits, not just the topology of the orbits. I want to consider the following type of question. If you take three points like that, one in the middle of the order, I want to see the geometry in the image here. For example, if XL is very close to XK, it's much closer than than the distance to XJ, I want to ask if the same happens here or if the geometry is different. So this is the type of question that was considered by Arnold in 6.1, and he started by analyzing a very simple family of mappings. In this family here, we have two parameters, A and alpha. And for alpha equal to zero is just the family of rotations, of rigid rotation. And he added this simple term here, and this alpha, if alpha equal zero, as I said, is a rigid rotation. If alpha is smaller than one, it's easy to see that the derivative is always positive, and therefore we have a circle diffeomorphism. And if alpha is bigger than one, what happens is that the map is no longer invertible, and the dynamics is chaotic. I'm going to say a few words more about this situation here. And here we can look at the parameter space. Here is the parameter space. Here is alpha, A, the rotation. Here is alpha. What we see in the parameter space are some open regions like this one or this one. They are called tongues. If the parameter is inside a tongue, the behavior of the map is periodic. It has a periodic point, and it follows easily that if a circle homeomorphism has a periodic point, then all orbits are asymptotic to a periodic point. So the dynamics inside those tongues are very simple, and we have a countable number of tongues, and the union of the interior of these tongues are dense in the parameter space. But in the complement of those tongues, we have lines that go from the bottom to the top of the diagram, and to each irrational number here, we have a line going to the top made of points that have the same rotation number. So all points in the same line here, they are conjugate to the corresponding rotation in the bottom. If we take a one parameter family, if we fix a value of this parameter, alpha zero, and we take one parameter, one line like that, and then we get a family of one parameter family of circle diffeomorphism. And if we look at the rotation number, we can plot here the graph of the rotation number. Here is the A, the parameter A. Here is the rotation number. Alpha was fixed here. And we see that each time this line intersects the tongue, we see a plateau here where the rotation number is constant and rational here. And this curve, the graph of this function here, the rotation number, is a very wild curve. And of course, we want to analyze the nature of this curve and what. Then we can consider some values of the parameters. I'm mentioning here I alpha pi for irrational is just the set of parameters where the rotation number is irrational. Again, this is the family, and then we can inside this the alpha we can look at the rotation number that are far from the rationals. They satisfy some inequality like that. The distance is bigger or equal than the ratio of a constant to q to the power 2 plus beta, beta positive, and see a positive constant. This holding for all rationals p and q. And we may consider also the s alpha, the set of values such that the invariant measure being irrational, the rotation number, there is a unique invariant measure for the diffeomorphism, and we can ask whether this measure is not absolutely continuous, and this is the same as saying that the conjugacy is not absolutely continuous. With this definition, the basic results obtained by Arnold in 6.1 was that, as I mentioned before, the complement of irrationals, they contain a non-open and dense set. So the diffeomorphism that have a periodic behavior, they are open and dense. On the other hand, this bad set here, where the conjugacy is bad, is not even absolutely continuous. This is residual, so it contains a countable intersection of open and dependent set in pi alpha. So there are a lot of diffeomorphisms where the conjugacy is really bad, and Arnold in 6.1 and Perman and Yokos later, they proved that in this good set of rotation number, the conjugacy is smooth. So the geometry of the orbits is really very much like the situation in the rotation. This result of Arnold was for alpha close to zero. It was a perturbative result, and it had a tremendous impact because it was the first time where this small device or problem was handled, and it was a fundamental step towards this Arnold-Moser Kolmogorov Arnold-Moser theory. So this was just before they proved the general case. And also, again, for small values of the parameter alpha and Hermann for the general situation, this set where the conjugacy is smooth with a rotation has positive Lebesgue measures. So it's a really big set of parameters. Well, what I want to go now is to go beyond that. In that family, I said that for alpha smaller than one, we have diffeomorphism, this simple behavior. And when alpha equal to 1 is just the boundary of the chaotic region, when you pass to, from simple dynamic to chaotic dynamic. And this type of situation was very much observed by the physicists in the 80s, like Feigenbaum and Kadanoff and others. and they made a lot of interesting discussion about this situation, and this is the topic of my talk. So what I'm going to discuss now are the what we call critical circle map. Is I'm going to discuss this in the general situation, and this applies also to the special, to this standard family of maps. Okay, then a critical circle mapping is just a orientation preserving C3 circle homeomorphism with exactly one critical point of odd type, say cubic. Okay, and then of course, if there is some periodic points, the dynamic is trivial. I mean, every point is asymptotic to a periodic point, and all periodic points have the same period. So I'm going to consider only maps that have irrational rotation numbers. Okay, so the first basic result in this direction was Yokos in 1984, where he proved the analog of the Danjoie theorem. He proved that if you take any C3 critical circle map and the rotation number being irrational, then it is minimal, meaning that all orbits are dense in the circle. In particular, this proves that the conjugacy to a rotation to the corresponding rotation, there is a conjugacy. Of course, this conjugacy cannot be smooth because the map has a critical point. So it does not make much sense if we want to understand the geometry of the orbits to compare the map with a rotation, but we should compare two such maps with the same criticality. So then, after the work of all those physicists, a conjecture was made by Lamford in the 80s. And the conjecture was that if you take two C3 critical circle maps of bounded type, I'm going to the rotation number being irrational and of bounded type, I'm going to explain this later, then they are conjugated by a C1 plus alpha circle diffeomorphism. Well, this alpha is not the same as the parameter. It's a universal alpha that I'm going to discuss later. Okay. Bounded type is, as I was mentioned, in the statement, is just a number here has bounded type if the distance to any rational number p over q is bigger or equal epsilon over q square. This for any rational p and q. So those are the most natural the numbers that are further from the rationals. We can also express this situation using the continued fraction expansion of the number theta, and this condition is equivalent of saying that all the coefficients in the continued fraction expansion are bounded. There is a universal bound for the, that's why we call it bounded type. So this is the conjecture. In fact, many physicists before, like Kadanoff, Feigenbaum, and so on, they were considering a special case of this conjecture where the number was just the golden mean, which is the simplest number of bounded type where all the coefficients in the continued fraction were equal to one. So this is but then Lamford came and made this general conjecture. This set of number of bounded type satisfying this condition here is not so big. It's not, it has measure zero, but has house of dimension equal to one. So it's not that small either. I mean, it's quite a big set of numbers, but still having zero Lebesgue measure. And then the first theorem in this direction took quite a long time to prove, the first case for bounded type were proved by myself and Edson de Faria, and then Jampolsky, and then Honey and Templinski. And using the result of all those people, we can state the general result for real analytic maps. If you have F and G to critical circle maps with the following properties, F and G are real analytic, and the rotation number are equal and irrational. But I should add here that also the criticality is the same. I mean, they are, say, cubic, the critical point. Then we can consider by your cos, there is a conjugacy between F and G, and we can consider the conjugacy that maps the critical point of F to the critical point of G. Then the conclusion is that H is always a C1 diffeomorphism. Here we see a difference between this, it's better than the situation in circle diffeomorphism, where this conjugacy for circle diffeomorphisms can be quite wild, whereas here it's always C1, at least C1. So the geometry of the orbit is determined by the combinatorics. The second statement is that the conjugacy might not be C1 plus alpha everywhere, but at least at the critical point, it is C1 plus alpha by universal positive alpha. So it's more than C1 at least at the critical point. And also for a full Lebesgue measure set of rotation numbers that contains all bounded type, H is globally C1 plus alpha for this universal alpha. I'm going to discuss a little bit ingredients of the proof. It's quite complicated. There are a lot of ingredients, but I'll just describe a few of them. And then the main theorem I'm going to discuss. As I mentioned, the previous theorem is only true for real analytic maps, and it uses heavily complex analytic dynamics and complex analysis, several strong tools in complex analysis. And now what I'm going to discuss is how to extend this result for C3 maps. And so the theorem is that for maps of bounded type, the conjugacy is C1 plus alpha if the two maps have the same irrational rotation number and the same criticality at the critical point. Okay, this result is quite recent. It's about the thesis of my student, Pablo Guarino. He defended his thesis a few months ago. And we are also working, there is a work in progress with Pablo Guarino and Marco Martins. We are extending this result for all rotation numbers, exactly the same type of result that we had before for real analytic maps. So this is the where I still working on this problem, but I think we are quite close to the final solution.
For any
rational number, no arithmetic condition. Okay, so let me discuss about the tools. The main tool in this proof is the renormalization operator and asymptotically holomorphic maps. So the idea here is to analyze, since we want to control the small scale geometry of the orbits, we should focus in small neighborhoods of the critical point, and we look at the first return maps to this small and small neighborhood, and we scale it back to a given size. So this gives us a sequence of dynamical system. And in fact, we can extend this idea and construct an infinite dimensional space of dynamical systems and an operator, a nonlinear operator acting in this infinite dimension. And we want to analyze the dynamics of this operator. And the geometry of the orbits of a given map is going to be determined by this the dynamics of this nonlinear operator. So to be more precise here, what we do is the following. Given a number rho irrational, we have always a sequence of rational number that are the best approximation of this irrational, meaning that we have this inequality here. The distance from rho to Pn of Qn is less than or equal to this distance for all Q smaller than Qn. Okay. If we look at this special iterates here, Qn, we get an interval between this iterate and the next one of this sequence here, and this interval contains the critical point. And if we look at the first return map to this interval, we get a situation like that. The interval splits in two parts, into subinterval. The critical point is here. We have the map, the first return map correspond to two iterates. One of them map this interval to this interval, and the other one, this interval to this other one. It is discontinuous at the critical point, but it's like an interval exchange transformation, except that it's nonlinear, right? Coming back to the previous slide. So those two maps correspond exactly to the iterates here. In fact, since both mappings are iterates, different iterates of the original map, they commute. Then we can extend these ideas to an abstract set of dynamical system, which you call the space of normalized critical commuting pairs. And Lamford observed that there is a strong relation between critical commuting pairs and the smooth conjugacy class of critical circle map. And the reason for that is the following, because given a pair of mappings like that, if they commute at zero here, we can use the dynamics here to identify this endpoint with that endpoint and get a circle. And in the circle with this identification, because of this commuting relation, the corresponding map we get is continuous, in fact, a smooth map of the circle. So this is the idea that we can go from commuting pairs to circle maps. But this relation is a bit subtle and creates some problems. So before you want to see the graph of the map is like that. This is one part of the map that maps this interval to the other side, and then the other map would be something like that. And the operator is starting with a mapping like that. We just iterate this one until it goes to the other side of the map, and then we get another mapping, pair of mappings here. This one is just a restriction of this one to a smaller interval, and the other one is just the iterate that makes this coming back. So the image of this mapping here, this pair, is just this other pair in this smaller interval. But then we scale up this interval to the original side, and then we get this dynamical system of okay. And then to prove this theorem, we used the theorem that was proved before by myself and Edson de Faria, which is the following, that there is a subset here of Clebsch measure one that contains the set of bounded type, such that if we have two critical circle maps with the same rotation number in this set here, then when we iterate this procedure here, the renormalization operator, then the distance between those two maps goes to zero exponentially fast. Well, if we have this condition, then we can prove that F append is plus 1 plus alpha. So to prove the conjecture, we have to prove this exponential convergence of the renormalization operator. So this is this theorem reduces the question to prove this this statement here. And then for general rotation number, there was a more recent paper by Honey and Templisky in Invenciones 2007, where they proved that the same statement here proved the C1 rigidity for any irrational rotation number. But now we can use this previous result because we are going to consider only bounded type rotation numbers. Well, and then to get rigidity for real analytic maps, the next statement that was proved by those two papers, where in the case of real analytic maps, then we do get the exponential convergence. And the important thing that we are going to use here is that this constant, it in general depends on F and G. The lambda is universal, but the constant may depend on F and G. But this constant is uniform if F and G are in a compact set of real analytic maps. This here is this statement here is going to be used in our proof. So using those two results, then we had the rigidity for real analytic maps. So the problem is. Just before going on, I just mentioned that the proof of this theorem here, the exponential convergence here, uses heavily a lot of tools coming developed by Sullivan, McMullen, Liubich, and Alfred Behrs, and a lot of Thurston, and a lot of things. It's really quite involved. But we are going to use this now. What is this again? So, this is the theorem we need to prove to get the rigidity, you know? As I mentioned before. And then the connection between the smooth map and the real analytic map is given by this theorem B, which is the real theorem we have to prove. The statement is the following, that there is a compact set of real analytic critical commuting pairs with the following property. Given any C3 critical circle map with any rational rotation number, theta, then there exists a constant, a positive constant, by universal lambda here. This lambda, in fact, does not depend on theta. It's really universal. And also a sequence of real analytic maps in this compact, such that this sequence shadows the orbit of the renormalization operator of this C3 map, meaning that the distance between the n iterate of the original map with this real analytic map is exponentially small. Okay, so this is the first statement, and also what is needed here is that the rotation number of this iterate here and the rotation number of this real analytic map is the same. Well, and then having this theorem and the previous theorems, we prove the general result. So this is what we have to do. We have to prove that that we can shadow this orbit here by a family of real analytic map with this control here. And then we have to use, as before, the exponential contraction of POF2 real analytic map. And then having this situation, and with some Lipschitz control upon this operator, we get the final result. So the real difficult part of the proof is the proof of this theorem here. And the other tool I said we use is the notion of asymptotically holomorphic maps. So the idea, we are looking at real maps, maps of the real line, but we extend this map A circle map, we can look at a map of the rail line that commutes with translation by integers. And then we extend this map to the complex plane. And we want this extension to be asymptotically holomorphic. I mean, the extension is just, of course, C3 map of the plane now, of a region in the plane, a region like that, strip around the real line. And we want that the d bar derivative of f is zero at the real line. And more than that, it converges to zero uniformly when the imaginary part goes to zero, and also it converges even divided by the square of the this extension is quite easy to construct extension like that. And then, what I'm going to do with this extension is to use tools analog to that were used before in the case of holomorphic maps. And one of the tools we use is hyperbolic geometry, because if we want to analyze iterates of some interval, we can look at this interval as embedded in the plane, and then we can consider the domain in the plane, which is just the complement of the real line when we add the interval. So this is a simply connected domain in the plane. And being simply connected, it is conformally equivalent to the unit disk. And by symmetry here, there is a conformal involution of this. This means, this implies that the image of this can be taken to be one a segment like that, and here we have the hyperbolic metric of Poincaré, and then we have the corresponding hyperbolic map here. And then we use the Schwarz lemma, saying that if you take a holomorphic map of a space into itself, it contracts the hyperbolic map. Well, in this hyperbolic geometry here, we can consider the set of points in the domain here that are whose distance to the interval I, which is the geodesic of is smaller than some number. This is a Poincaré disk. It's just the set of points whose distance to I is less than R of theta, and this is easy to see that it's a region like that. It made of two pieces of Euclidean disks like that, symmetric, and this is exactly the set of points that, and so if we have a holomorphic map in the whole domain, we have a contraction of this. The image of a region like that goes inside the corresponding region in the image of the interval I. And what we have to discuss here is that if we have a map with asymptotic, which is conformally asymptotic, then if we take an interval very small, and then we can we have an estimate saying that, well, we don't have a contraction, but the image would be contained in a slightly bigger Poincaré disk. And so this is one of the main, I think I don't have much time to go into the details of the proof. I'll just split it. And then, using these estimates and the iterate, we prove that perhaps that if we go deep enough in this construction, and then we have extension of the original maps of the interval to domains in the complex plane, and the point here is that those domains are not too small and are not too big, so we get in some compactness region of the of maps compact in this C0 topology. This is what I call geometric bounds, and also with this in this construction, if we go deep enough. All those maps here have exponential small conformal distortion. This is given by the Beltrami coefficients of the maps. Okay, well, then there is a more complicated construction here. We have to go back to circle maps, but now in the complex idea. And then we have to use Alfvén-Weierstrass theorem to approximate those maps by complex analytic maps here. We then use this to construct maps in cylinders that we can uniformize as annulus, and then we approximate the original C3 maps by real analytic map with control of the with exponential small distance. And this is the idea of the proof of the theorem. So I should stop here. Those are some of the references I was discussing.
Thank you. Okay.